سخرية ridiculing others or insulting others. Don't insult people. Don't ridicule them. Number 19, التنابز بالألقاب, calling each other nicknames that the other is not accepting. Calling each other nicknames, التنابز بالألقاب. Allah said in the Quran, بئس الاسم بعد الفسوق الإيمان. The worst thing you do to yourself after saying I'm a believer is to insult somebody by calling them a name they don't want. Nowadays this is normal. We all call names to one another and this and that. Sometimes they have nicknames, people want them. Yeah? Like for example in Sudan, if a girl called Fatima, they call her Fitim or Fatim. But like we call it Dala. Yes, okay? But in the West now, if somebody look at you and give you a name because of your race or because of your color, or to insult you, that's haram in Islam. Especially if the person is angry about it. Don't do that. Okay? Now, all these diseases are dangerous. You can read about them. There's a lot of information on this. But I'm going to concentrate in the time remaining in two of them. Number one, arrogance. Why I'm talking about it? Because it's a description of shaitan. Once you are arrogant, you are a shaitan. You are come under the umbrella of shayateen al-ins, the shayateen of the humans. And Iblis was thrown out of the Jannah because Allah said he acted with arrogance. He says, وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا. When we commanded the angels to prostrate for Adam, indeed all they prostrated. إِلَّا Iblis. Except for Iblis, Abba, he refused, was takbar, and he acted with arrogance. وَكَانَ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ. And because of this act, his iman was taken away and he became a kafir. Yes? Pardon? He was number one. Number one. He had the best title. The first racist. The father of all racists. Yeah? The father of all arrogant people. Yes? I'm going to come to it. Yeah? Inshallah. That's the reason why I'm doing this, but I want to give you some evidence. This is Surah Al-Baqarah, verse 34. If for those who want the evidence, Allah says at the end of that verse, وَاللَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُسْتَكْبِرِينَ. Allah dislikes the arrogant people. So if Allah dislike it and you have it, you are disliked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Surah Al-Nahl, the bees, verse 23, Allah says, إِنَّهُ لَا يُحِبُّ الْمُسْتَكْبِرِينَ. Allah indeed dislike those who act with arrogance. In Surah Luqman, verse 18, Allah said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ كُلَّ مُخْتَالٍ فَخُورٍ. Allah dislikes every arrogant boaster. Every arrogant boaster. In Surah Luqman, verse 18, Allah dislikes. Once you are an arrogant person, your heart is stamped by a stamp. Like when the farmer or the sheep herder or the cattle herder, they have a stamp for their cattle to be known which is which. So your heart is, you are known as the hypocrite. One of the men, and subhanAllah, I'll read this to you, of the companion of Prophet, he used to know who the hypocrite. Can you imagine if somebody here now he knows who the hypocrite? Could bear a sign in the face. But Allah is so generous, he doesn't show it. The Prophet said, Allah will teach some of my ummah how to read the sign of the hypocrite. All of us can know from lying and breaking promises, these are the big signs. And when you, but there is physical sign. You look at the person, you could see the sign that he's the hypocrite. You know straight away. Not all of us will know. One of the companions called Huzayfa ibn al-Yaman, he was one of them. Umar ibn Khattab was not one of them. So when he heard Huzayfa ibn al-Yaman, okay, knows, Umar came to him when they passed him by. And he said to him, to test him. He said, Sayyidi Umar ibn Khattab, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, laqiya Huzayfa ibn al-Yaman. He met Huzayfa in the way, they're passing in the street. He said to him, كيف أصبحت يا حزيفة؟ How did you wake up this morning? How do you feel? Like a normal question. This is what Hudhayfa said. أصبحت أحب الفتنة. I woke up this morning, I love fitna. Dangerous. What's going on? وأكره الحق. And I dislike and hate the truth. وأصلي بغير وضوء. And I woke up today and I pray without wudu. ولي في الأرض ما ليس لله في السماء. And I have on this earth, أي حذيفة, that I wish Allah doesn't have in the heavens. Did you hear what I said? This is dangerous. A man is telling a man who's sourced, it will kill him. With Umar was tough. Okay? I woke up this morning, Umar, I love fitna, I dislike the truth, I pray without wudu, and I have on the earth that which Allah doesn't have in the heaven. فغضب عمر غضب. Umar was so angry. And to control himself, he just went into Ali's house. Ali ibn Abi Talib. Okay, it says here, فدخل على علي بن أبي طالب كرم الله وجهه and أمير المؤمنين علي said to him, يا أمير المؤمنين يا عمر, I see in your face the sign of anger, and not just anger, you are raging with anger. Umar told him what happened, but Hudhayfa told me whatever he told me. Okay, Ali, look at Ali ibn Abi Talib. This is why he is one of the beautiful men of this kind of path. We follow kind of his teaching. Okay? He says, he has spoken the truth, Ya Umar. Umar said to him, what? He has spoken, he told you the truth. Are you telling me he loves fitna and he is speaking the truth? He said, yes. He prays for us, wudu. What kind of? He said, yes, study the truth. He has in the earth what Allah does. What kind of thing you're telling me? He said, no, Allah is telling you the truth. And look what he explained, what he said to him. يُحِبُّ الْفِتْنَةَ يَعْنِ الْمَالِ. He loves fitna, he means money. I woke up this morning, I love money. Because Allah said in the Quran, for money, he called money fitna. Because he knows the Quran. He called children fitna. إِنَّمَا أَمْوَالُكُمْ وَأَوْلَادُكُمْ فِتْنَةً. Indeed, your wealth and your children are fitna. Look at Ali, look at the cleverness. Don't just jump and give an answer. For everything you want to say, there is an answer in the Quran. وَمَا فَرَّطْنَا فِي الْكِتَابِ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. We have never left anything that we did not mention in the Quran. Okay? وَيَكْرَهُ الْحَقِّ. He dislike the truth. He means the death. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, death is true. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةَ الْمَوْتِ. This is true. He created death. وَيُصَلِّ بِغَيْرِ وَدُوءٍ. He means to make salawat for the Prophet ﷺ. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. You didn't need wudu for it. It is absolutely essential to understand what people mean by what they want to do. Okay? And salatul nabi, you can do it in any time, in any place. Nobody can tell you. Sitting, reclining, walking, no wudu, it's fine. And he had on the earth, which Allah does not have in the heaven, he have a wife and children. Does Allah have a wife and children? Look what Umar said. He said, oh Ali, you are always wise and you are always say the best of gems. Ya Abul Hassan, oh father of Hassan, you have taken from my heart that which will make me a hypocrite. Because if I treated him with respect and I went with him, I will have in my heart that I hate him. Because he does, and I will have whisper. Hudhayfa, you know Hudhayfa, he prayed for us wudu. It's not happening today. We hear news and we're just passing it. Yeah, we don't do that because this is dangerous. Then look at Ali. Ali ibn Abi Talib, in regard of this, to know the truth. A man came to him and said to me, Ali, ibn Abi Talib, I want to ask you four things. Clever. Four things. Ali said, awesome. He said, mal wajib. What is that which is compulsory? وَمَا أَوْجَبْ مِنْهُ. What is more important than the compulsory? وَمَا الْقَرِيبُ. What is near to me and I should work on it? وَمَا أَقْرَبُ مِنْهُ. What is more closest than it? وَمَا الْعَجَبُ. What? That thing which makes me surprised or be in a position of being surprised, and what is more surprising for me than that? وَمَا الصَّعَبُ. What is the most difficult thing? وَمَا أَصْعَبُ مِنْهُ. What is more difficult than that? When you listen to this, why is he asking those questions? But the lesson from it will teach you that indeed you need to learn and to understand the Quran is not a book that you read and just the literal word is the answer. There is deeper inner words in the Quran to make you go further. Okay? Ali then said to him, Al-Wajib, your duty, which is compulsory, is to repent. Putting himself in a position of sinning. But more important than repenting, to leave sinning. To avoid sinning. Because you need to sin to repent. And that which is near is Qiyamah. Qiyamah is very near. But more near than Qiyamah, forget about Qiyamah. Now everyone talking about, oh, Qiyamah is coming near. Okay, no. But what did I prepare for Qiyamah? Remember death. What is nearer than Qiyamah is death. Your Qiyamah starts when you die. Okay? But that which is surprising and amazingly surprising all of us and taking us on a ride is dunya. Everybody is loving it, running after it. But what's more surprising is loving the dunya. You know it is low. It's called dunya. And you love it for what? You should not love the dunya, you should love the akhirah. You should not work for the dunya, you should work for the akhirah. Why? Because Allah told you so. Okay? وَمَا الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا لَعِبٌ وَلَهُ. This dunya is only fun and games, nothing else. And what is difficult is the grave. Very difficult. But more difficult than the grave is entering your grave without any provision, without insurance. Look at this. This gives you the thing that you need to concentrate upon. Don't worry about Qiyamah. Qiyamah is going to come, but worry about when you're going to die. Okay? This is important. Don't worry about the punishment of the grave. If it's going to happen. But what is the provision you prepared so that you are not punished in the grave? All right? So in this sense, Ali ibn Abi Talib becomes one of those people whom Allah has given him the wisdom to make us think so that we can save ourselves. The person whose arrogance, the sister asked, what are his signs? Allah does not love him. Allah does not love him. And because Allah doesn't like him, when you see him, you don't like him. Straight away. Some people say to me, I met somebody, but instinctively I didn't like them. Because he's mutakabbar. Okay? Allah despises him. Allah shuns him. And therefore, when you see him, people don't want to be friends with them at all. I had never seen an arrogant person. People say, what a wonderful person. There is a hadith of Rasulullah says, Al-Mu'min ilfun alif. Al-Mu'min ilfun alif. The believer is friendly. Easily befriended. Listen carefully. Al-Mu'min ilfun alif. The believer, the real believer, is so friendly. Anybody said, MashaAllah, what a wonderful man. What a wonderful woman. Easily you can make friendship with them. وَلَا خَيْرَ فِي مَنْ لَا يَأْلَفْ وَلَا يُؤْلَفْ. However, there is no benefit in the one who does not befriend people or the one whom people run away from. They don't want him or her as a friend. وَلَا خَيْرَ فِي مَنْ لَا يَأْلَفْ وَلَا يُؤْلَفْ.
What about people though who are introverted and who might find befriending people difficult but actually
aren't arrogant? No, that can be true. But this is rare. These are exceptions. Because a lot of people are just quiet. I can't say they're arrogant, but they don't talk much. I know a lot of people that are in the majalis, and I always prefer to go and talk to them. Because they find them very good people. But their nature, they're insular. For one reason or another. Sometimes they feel shy. Sometimes they feel, I don't fit. They blame themselves. And you invite somebody from a lower kind of job into your office, or lower education. Sometimes they feel inadequate. I will always run to those people because I don't want them to feel like that. Come on, we're all equal. You understand? And give them food. But it doesn't mean they're arrogant. Yeah, that is right. Okay? يَطْبَعُ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ قَلْبِهِ. Allah, I said, I will mark his heart. I can't see his heart. But you can see his action. So once you see the action in him, which shows that he's looking down at somebody, or abusing somebody, ridiculing somebody publicly, Allah is manifesting the mark inside by the action for you to know this is hypocrisy. For example, you are gathering in a place and somebody whom you think he does not fit that place, rather than going quietly asking the person to come with me and then telling them your reason why you don't want them to be there in front of everybody, excuse me, what are you doing here? Don't you think this is only for the leaders or for the managers? You should go downstairs. It's insulting. It's embarrassing. This is arrogance. Immediately I know this, because a person who is normal will never embarrass somebody, will never demean somebody, will never put, the Prophet never did that, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even when he was invited to eat food in people's houses, he didn't like it. He did not say, I dislike it. Never. Yeah? This is something, so he will hear them, because that means they are doing something which is not correct. The person also who is arrogant, he will never take a lesson. You cannot win with them. When you are arguing with them, no. They are always right. I am right. My way or the highway. I don't argue with them. Once I die, yes, I leave them alone. I keep my way to my way. And listen to this hadith. Allah said in hadith Qudsi, Al-Kibriya Urida'i. Kibriya is the garment that I wear. Wal-Azama Idari. And acting, okay, with pride is also a garment that I wear. فَمَنْ نَازَعَنِي وَحِدًا مِنْهُمَا أَلْقَيْتُهُ فِي النَّارِ Whosoever tried to take one of those two attributes to himself, I will throw them in the hellfire. Allah called المتكبر. There is nobody else has a position. You have no right to ridicule, insult, slander, abuse, and put down anybody. You have no right. You have no right to backbite them, spread rumors about them, slander them, or even think or feel bad about them. It is all verses of the Quran. Okay? It's forbidden. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, يُحْشَرَ الْمُتَكَبِّرِينَ وَالْقِيَامَةِ مِثْلَ الذَّرِّ. The arrogant people in the Day of Judgment, Allah will reduce their size, very, very small, and they will be thrown in the hellfire with humiliation, because they were trying to act big. Allah wants to show them they are nothing. This is in Tirmidhi. The Prophet ﷺ said as well, whosoever tried to act within himself as great, looking in the mirror in the morning and saying, that's it, I'm all. If anybody sees otherwise, they can't see the truth. I am everything. Okay, I'm handsome, I'm intelligent. If you notice now, that program which Mr. Sugar does, what do you call it? Imagine in this modern day and age, a man interviewed, how can you convince me you're going to make me say, I'm a very good liar? Does it make sense? And it's in television. I'm a very good liar. I know how to make money. That means I can deceive, I can keep. And if our world, Bismillah, if our world is built like this, upon cheating and lying and deceiving, then something is not very right. Ma'alish. Yeah? He just fell. This is natural. We all get worried. We have to fall. Some people want to cushion them, build cushion around them. If they don't fall, they will never learn anything. Just like us, if we don't fail in dunya, we cannot progress. Yeah? We have to fail and to seek forgiveness for that. Yeah? So whosoever act arrogant within himself and walked with pride, لقي الله هو غضبان عليه. He will meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah is angry with him or her. So don't glorify yourself. Don't praise yourself or overpraise yourself, and do not walk with arrogance. Yes? I can't hear. Most of the arrogant things, yeah, you can see them. People who act arrogant, you see it. No, but there are some hidden in the sense that, because arrogance comes from a heart of somebody who have hypocrisy. In order to fit, sometimes they act normally. For example, your boss, he doesn't like you because you're wearing a hijab, although you do your job perfect. So alone, he's mistreating you, abusing you, shouting at you, bullying you, But within the rest of the community of the work, he treats you like everybody else. So if you complain, he said, when did I do that? Do you understand? So there's something hidden. And he can fight his corner because publicly he will show respect to you. But privately he puts you down. Yeah? And you feel that pressure within yourself. It's happening a lot. Okay? And then subhanAllah, he says sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لا يدخل الجنة من كان في قلبه مثقال ذرة من كبر. The one who has a fraction of an atom weight of arrogance in his heart, he will not enter paradise. Yeah? This is the Prophet ﷺ says that. One man says, يا رسول الله, الرجل يحب أن يكون ثوبه حسنا. This is important for you. The man loves to have a beautiful set of clothes. You can go and buy designer clothes. Nothing wrong with that. I love that, but I'm not arrogant, يا رسول الله. ونعله حسن. I would like to buy the best trainers, Nike, worth 3,500 pounds. What's wrong with that? The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said to him, إن الله جميل يحب الجمال. Look at his answer. This man who is rich, who buys the best of clothes, best of shoes, when he heard that he felt shy. Because today, the new da'iyah, they tell you, you are wasting money, people are hungry, and you are wearing a shoe worth 500 pounds. So what? Maybe Allah gave me 10,000 pounds for shoes. To buy 500 shoes, nothing. Allah gave you, okay, 1,000 pounds, and you went and bought a shoe for 20 pounds. So what's wrong? I can buy whatever I want to buy according to my income. So don't confuse arrogance with spending on yourself. Once a man came to me, said to me, look, I was famous once. Everybody knows me, I have a lot of money. I was rich. I was in a status whereby even kings and queens want to meet me. But then I became a Muslim and my life changed. People around me told me, don't drive expensive cars, don't wear expensive clothes. I don't mind wearing just nice, decent clothes, but I really love my Mercedes-Benz and the latest fashion model. I said to him, do you have the money? He said, I have my money. How much is the latest going to cost? He said, maybe 100,000 or more. Do you have that kind of money? He said, yes, I can buy it today. I said to him, go and buy one. Are you sure? You are driving an old banger. Are you sure? I said, yes. Believe me, the pleasure he had when he came driving it, that you would like to have a ride. I said, of course. Then he asked me, what is your reasoning? I said, my sheikh told me, if you don't spend according to what Allah is giving you on yourself, and you just hoard it and put it in an account, or just, you are the most wicked person out of God. You are ungrateful. If Allah give me 1,000 pounds and give Dean 10,000 pounds, and he said, let's go and have lunch, and Dean ordered the meal for 10 pounds because he doesn't want to squander, and I order a meal for 10 pounds, who is more generous in showing gratitude in the sight of God? He or me? Me, because I spent in proportion more money. If he did the same, he should spend 100 pounds in his meal. And if he did, what's wrong with that? Yes?